we move over to our use of we have said that the classes consist of objects and the objects have contrast this with the variables, arrays and structures are something that we have been routinely using in most of the earlier discussion in this course. These, by the way, are considered the native facilities available with any programming language. Consider, for example, a declaration of the type int m, n. What you get are two locations assigned, one for m, one for n. If somewhere you make a statement, m is equal to 28, n is equal to 5*m+37. What you are doing is you are writing expressions to make assignments. These expressions are evaluated as per the standard rules provided in any programming language, and most programming languages have exactly similar rules, because the simple arithmetic of integer, floating point or the char manipulation, etc., are done almost identically. Why are they called native to a programming language? Because explicit operations, explicit expression rules, explicit assignment rules, etc., are all defined specifically for all the elements which are operated upon in this fashion. So, for example, the operator plus, minus, star have specific meaning, equal to has a specific meaning. The moment we use a variable name, it has a specific meaning that that variable name corresponds to a location in memory and a value internally represented in a certain form has to be used. That is how we know that integer is represented separately, floating point is represented separately, char is represented separately. Later on we discussed, using the conventional means only, whether we can create superstructures where a superstructure has several components. These components in turn could be simple variables. For example, array is a superstructure. A superstructure of 200 elements, 1000 elements of the same type. A struct is a superstructure. A struct could in turn contain a data element which is integer, another element which is floating point, another element which is an array, and so on. And we discussed that these effectively permit us to define what we call additional abstract data types. The basic data types are int, float, etc. But these additional data types permit us to handle more complex structures as a single entity. It is in this context that we discuss that if a struct is defined, then how a structure variable, say S, can be used to define not only its components, because whenever you declare a structure variable S of the structure type, let's say employee, then that S automatically gets allocated memory for all the elements of that structure. So you have S.empid, S.empname, S dot something referring to member element. Needless to add, these individual member elements have still to be operated upon by using the normal rules of addition, subtraction, assignment, concatenation, whatever. We take this notion itself to one level higher when we talk about an object. The difference is that if we write some functions in conventional sense, the function declaration and function usage has a specific meaning. For example, I could say F1 obviously is not an array, okay, it's a function. It has two parameters m and n. We don't know what F1 does. Obviously, there will have be a prototype definition and the full implementation. But let us say it calculates square root of m into n, or m square plus n square square root, or just m plus n, or just whatever. We don't know what it does. But it will return a value. Now, when I make such a call, it's a standalone call, it does not make any sense. The return value, what you are going to do with it? So that is why in normal functions, you have a return type, and you would usually have this as something like p equal to f1m, n, where you might declare p as int. So our notion is that whenever you invoke a function f1 with some parameters, these parameters go to that function and some return value comes back. There are occasions when a single return value does not come back, but multiple values are modified and are sent back. And that is what you call parameter passing by reference. We have discussed pointers in this context and how to pass parameters by reference and so on. In case of objects, there is a fundamental difference. While there could be some public functions which could be called and which may involve multiple objects, in general, an object itself invokes functions in order to modify itself or in order to give you out some information about itself. And that is a fundamental difference between the functions which are written for object classes and the functions that we ordinarily write. For example, if I have a class rational, we shall see in a moment. You remember we had discussed this. We had discussed this class earlier. We had data called so denominator and numerator. We said that's the component of the rational class. Now, whenever there is an object that is declared which is of class rational, it will automatically be assigned two memory locations, one to contain denominator, one to contain numerator. Ordinarily, in my main program, I will be never assigning anything to D or N, nor I will be using D or N dialect. The idea of defining an object is I use an object in the context of wherever I wish to do something. This is where we had used, can you read this? So you'll remember this class rational, where I define private data members as N and D, and then I define member functions. You'll remember we had constructors. Please note that these are all definitions of the interface. The functions themselves are not defined here. Usually you break up the definition of the interface and the definition of implementation in two separate parts. As I said, the implementation part could be compiled independently and made available as a class library, but the interface part must be available in the source form, because without that interface part being included, your normal program cannot be compiled which uses the member functions to perform certain things on these objects. Okay. So that is why you usually have them as say something dot h as a header file. In this particular case, I have a single header file which contains both the definition of interface as well as the definition of member function, though it is not necessary. We had not seen the destructor. The destructor is being defined here. It has a standard name, tilde, name of the class. So please remember, constructors and destructors have the same name as the class name. This is an example of a constructor without parameters, an example of a constructor with two parameters. There are other functions. So you remember I had mentioned a function called rComponents, where given an object, I want to find out what are the denominator and numerator separately. So this rComponent is a member function which will get me two variables, which are integer, and I will return into those two variables the numerator and denominator component. There was an observation made on this void R component int and int and. What is this kind of reference? We are generally used to having a reference in which we define a pointer as a formal parameter and we say and m or and n in the parameter which actually calls this function. so that the pointer is passed. That is the standard way of passing by reference. C++ introduces a implicit parameter passing by reference, and this is an example of that. I will explain the difference in a short while, but this is the standard way of doing things. Here is a function called reduce. There is another function which I have introduced called rconvert. This rconvert converts a single integer into a rational. So, for example, I just give 5, what I mean is 5 by 1, but 5 is an integer number, is not a rational number, so I can't use it as a rational object. Essentially, I am constructing dynamically a rational object given only one parameter. Please note that I have already a constructor function defined, but this constructor function will be used ordinarily when I declare objects in my program. During that declaration, any pre-assigned values which I want to give, I can give, and the constructor will be invoked to use those. But if I want to dynamically assign values to numerator and denominator of a class object, how do I do that? There are two ways of doing it. One is to invoke the operating system to give you dynamically some memory and ask C++ to dynamically create an object, during which time the constructor can be invoked actually. We have not seen that yet. We will see that briefly in the next week's lecture. There is a command called new. When you say new something, that new something is created, okay, that object is created. However, if ordinarily I want to assign numerator, denominator values to an object which I have declared but not assigned anything except the default value, then I have written this thing called rconvert. It will take an integer number and create a object using that number as the denominator. Here are some examples of overloaded operators. You remember last time we discussed that the overloaded operator, I had given you an example saying I want to define plus as an additional operator which can operate upon two objects of the class rational. Basically, I want to define arithmetic on rational numbers. Now, we can have a function which does addition of two rationals and returns a rational, but a much easier and simpler way is to redefine the operator itself. Last time I had tried to show you a sample definition of this overloaded operator, thinking that since it is a function call and since the operation of addition will happen upon two parameters, I will pass two parameters to it. Then I had said, please think about it, whether that is the correct version. It so transpires that when I want to overload an operator, the operator overloading cannot be done in this sense, because operator overloading is treated as an equivalent of a function call by the calling function. So let me just go back to, let's say I have declared rational C1, say R1, R2, R3, etc. And somewhere I want to say, I want to make such a statement. Remember, last time we had seen an example where I had written an add rational function. So I could get R1 and R2 passed as two object parameters and get the final addition. But here I want the normal plus operator itself to work exactly as it works in the normal sense. Now this plus operator is actually treated as a function call. And the second operand is treated as a parameter. So it is as if I am saying please note that I can make this kind of call if I have written a function somewhere which takes one rational as a parameter. So this is being invoked by R1 itself. So obviously, any changes that happen to R1 will be reflected in R. In exactly the same fashion, instead of this function, plus symbol is treated as the name of the function. And R2 is treated as a parameter to the function. And R1 is treated as the invoking object. That's the reason why when you overload operators, plus, minus, star, slash, these are all binary operators in that they require two operands. The first operand is considered to be an invoking object. The first operand invokes the operation of plus, minus, star, slash, and the second operand becomes a parameter. So, whichever operand invokes that operation, see R1 plus R2, R1 minus R2, R1 is the object which is invoking that operation, and therefore R2 will be added to R1, R2 may be subtracted from R1, R2 will be multiplied with R1, or R1 will be divided by R2. The second operator, therefore second object, has this significance. There is a difference between the meaning of the first and second. So it is, yeah, very good point. His question is, what is if I have R1 plus R2 plus R3? I'm glad you made this point, because this is precisely the reason why we would like to overload the operators without killing the normal semantics associated with that operator. The normal semantics associated with arithmetic operators is that they could come in any combination in an expression. And if there are multiple such operations defined in an expression, then there are rules of precedence which have been defined, and at any one time only one operation takes place. So let me expand this further by saying, let us take this operation. Imagine for a moment that R1, R2, R3 are not rational objects, but simple integer or floating point numbers. Now what would happen if they are simple integer or floating point numbers? The standard precedence rule will state that amongst all these operations which are defined, multiplication and division are at higher level, and therefore this operation should be done first. Any operation which is done will result in a value of the same type. So if it is integer, it will result in an integer. In our case, since it is rational, we expect the same rules to be applied. So if star, plus, minus, etc. are all been overloaded properly and have been defined in this context, C++ will automatically determine the same precedence which applies to plus minus R. And it will examine this, actually calculate using the overloaded multiplication operation, and it will give me a star, say temp T1, RT1 as the result. It's a temporary object of that kind. This replaces the occurrence of R3 star R4. Now, the resulting expression is R1 plus R2 plus RT1 minus R5. All these operations are at the same precedence level, and the C++ defines that these operations should be carried from left to right. Therefore, now it will do R1 plus R2, which is what would have happened if you had simply R1 plus R2 plus R3. R1 plus R2 has precedence. This will result in another temporary rational number, RT2, let us say. Now the expression is RT2 plus RT1 minus R5. RT2 plus RT1 will now be added using the overloaded operator. So this is the reason why when we overload operators, we would like to retain the natural flavor of the meaning of those operators. As long as we retain the natural flavor, C++ intelligently applies all the rules which are associated naturally with those operators. So all the precedence rules will be applied, etc., etc. So I hope that is clear. This will work. Here are some default constructions. Initialize a rational number. This is initializing a rational number with two parameters, with one parameter having a default value. Mention couple of things. First of all, the destructor function. Note that the destructor function does not require a body. It merely requires its definition for the sake of completion. All the objects which are created through definition of the kind that we are doing will get automatically destroyed at the end of the program. But whenever objects are dynamically created using a new statement, you will have the responsibility of invoking the destructor implicitly by deleting those objects whenever their job is done. At that time, this destructor function will be invoked, and you will delete that. But it does not require any body. It merely returns the memory that is used to the operating system. Notice that this is the way, I forgot to mention this int star m star n, and m and n. Let's go back temporarily to discuss this. Okay, you would be familiar with this kind of notation that we have used. Whenever we want to pass by reference, we say AND Q whenever we call that function. So we are saying we are passing a pointer, and as a formal parameter we write int star p. That has been the usage so far. This is the standard usage, because otherwise, as you know, C++ will only send values by copying those values. When you explicitly send it by reference, the value is copied, but what is copied is a pointer. A pointer is copied, and that pointer ensures that the actual operations will take place on the value that you have. So in case I change star p, for example here, apart from returning the result, if I change star p itself by saying star p is equal to 28, then the value of p will also be changed. Okay, unless it's a constant. There is another way of referencing, which is peculiar to C++. This facility does not exist in an earlier subset of C++ called language C. This has been introduced when C++ was designed, because the need for passing by reference is so often that C++ thought that a special way should be created to indicate that certain functions will receive their parameters only by reference. That means they will receive only pointer. This method is to say so you use AND P as a parameter definition when you define the function itself. Later on, when you invoke this function f1, you simply say f1q. Now, this is a different way of invoking. Ordinarily, when you say f1q, you assume that the value of q is being passed. But because the formal parameter is defined as AND something, then what is extracted out of the parameter that is passed is its pointer. And that pointer is made available there. It is therefore wrong to say AND P, AND Q for F1, because then it will become pointer to pointer kind of, it is illegal in fact. So this is the standard way of using a parameter passing mechanism in C++, particularly in the context of objects that you define. And that is why most of the object libraries that you notice, the function formal parameters which are defined in the function definition, we'll always say AND something, AND rational AND, or int AND, or float AND. They will actually receive a pointer, and therefore it is illegal to say AND again there. Notice that the left hand side shows the way in which you will pass parameters, for example, to functions which where you want the parameter to be modified. For example, scanf. In scanf, you have to say AND M, AND P, AND whatever in order to get those values. If you have declared your own function like this, that is how you have to use it. However, if you have declared a function like this, then you do not have to use that. You just say this, and what goes is a point. Is that clear? Having defined those operations, here is an example that we had seen. For example, I am defining an additional function called display. I could have made this display function part of the rational.h itself. I have chosen merely for demonstration that functions involving objects can also be written separately as part of your main program. Why would this be essential? This is essential when a class library is constructed by someone else and I am trying to use it. Take for example strings library or the stack library. While the class library does provide the basic functions as thought fit by the creators of that library, I might always require some additional function. And I might not have the facility to modify that class definition. Therefore, I might have to construct my own additional functions, which in turn may use public functions defined in that class. So that is why I am using this rational display function. It is invoked by any object. All that it does is, it defines c dot r components n comma d, x is equal to float n float d. So basically I am creating a object c by defining the r components using the values of n and d. Okay, I will output n and I will output d, and I will also output the floating point value. That is the objective here. Look at the main program. I have created C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7, arbitrary objects. These objects get created automatically. I am displaying these C1, C2, C3, etc. And then I am adding C1 and C2. I am adding, multiplying C2 and C3. And I am displaying these results. I am dividing C4 by C5. I am displaying that result. I am subtracting C6 from C5 and I am displaying that result. This is a simple sample thing I have done merely to demonstrate what kind of object arithmetic that you can do. The importance of defining a rational class is not simply to get an easy way of writing operations on the rationals. There is a larger importance, and that is associated with our ability to do arithmetic which is more precise. All of you remember that when I use floating point representation, I lose precision because I have a limited set of precision. We know that whenever we add or subtract large number of values, particularly values which are very close to each other, I might lose precision. Or I add values which are close to each other, I might lose precision. Or I add a very small value to a very large value, I might lose precision. To illustrate this, I have written a simple series summation program. Let us look at this. Consider summation of series, arithmetic series, geometric progression. You are familiar with those. So a plus a square plus a cube plus a raised to 4 is a geometric series. A plus 2a plus 3a plus 4a. Is a arithmetic series. How would you call a series a plus a plus a plus a plus a? Okay. What I am doing is I am showing that if I want to add given a value of a in the form of numerator and denominator, and if I give some actual value, what would happen to it? So I am saying that I want to add n terms of this series. I input the value of n. However, the value of the number a which I want to add is given in terms of denominator and numerator. Okay, sorry, this x is a mistake. This should be a here. Anyway, so look at the way the formula is written or the iteration is written. I say a is equal to numerator by float of denominator. Please note, if I say numerator by denominator, I will lose everything there, because it will be an integer division. So I convert into floating point and get it. And then the first term is 0, let's say. Now I add from 1 to n, sum is equal to sum plus a. So I keep adding a. Now 1 by 3 added 3 times should give me 1. But 1 by 3 converted into floating point will result in 0.33333. And when I add it 3 times, I will actually get 0.99999. Of course, the C++ will display the result as 1, but internally it will not be storing it as 1. If I add a large number of numbers, say 30,000, then I will suddenly see that after adding 30,000, I should have got what result? 10,000. I will not get 10,000, but I will get 9,999 point something something. That is where the loss of precision happens. If, however, I did the same arithmetic using rational arithmetic, I would not be subjected to this. So to demonstrate this, I have got another one here. So this is a simple series with rational sum. I have given numerator and denominator as 1 by 33, and I am adding 33,000 terms. The number is 1 by 33 whose value is 0.030303. Please note, this is not the exact value. After that, there is another 030303. By the way, 1 by 3 in decimal is not an ending decimal, it's a recurring decimal, so it will never end. Curiously, there are some decimal fractions which may result in non-recurring decimal, but when converted to binary fraction, they may become recurring. Because base 2 and base 10 are not compatible in the sense of representing floating point numbers. Okay. In any case, you can expect that when you operate upon floating point numbers, you will invariably get a loss of precision somewhere or the other. This is one example. So when I add the 33,000 term, which is 1 by 33, the value is still this, but the sum is 1000 by 1. Because I am doing a rational arithmetic, I am continuing to have my numerator, denominator at every stage of the addition. Finally, I am getting 1000 by 1. Here is a simple series sum example. I do 1 by 33. How many terms to be added? This, the sum turns out to be 999.539. This is not what you will see if you add only 3 terms or 9 terms. You will get an integer value because the floating point number which is converted for display by C++ in your cout statement automatically does moving upward the fractional value. But when you have a value like 539, there is not much that C++ can do. Okay. Here is another example. This time I have given the value of A as 1 upon 210. If you consider the factors of 210, they are what? 2, 3, 5, 7. Now, obviously, when you carry on the rational arithmetic and keep adding these numbers, okay, so this plus this plus this plus this plus this, somewhere, whenever the numerator becomes either 2 or 3 or 5 or 7, it will cancel out. And that is why when I add 21,000 numbers, the 21,000 term is still 0.0047619. Please remember, this is not exact. And the sum that is turned out is 99.9854. Whereas, if I just say multiply n by a is a different multiplication. A is still a fractional, there is a loss of precision in a single a, but when you multiply by n, the value comes very close to 100, C++ shows it as 100. So, n by a is not same thing as a added n times. That's a fundamental fact about floating point arithmetic. I would like you to remember always, because many of you would be doing engineering computations with numbers spanning millions of operations, additions, subtractions, multiplications and divisions, and a major portion of your mind activity will be spent on how to limit the errors in the floating point arithmetic that will come. On the other hand, if I do the same example with a rational summation, then I still get this number as 0047619, but the 21,000 term is again same, but the sum is 100 by 1. So, because the rational arithmetic, I will finally get 100 by 1, the value is 100. There are couple of questions at the end of that printout which I would like you to remember to look at. Can you read out that? I think one of them is, under what circumstances this will not work. So can you tell me under what circumstances this will not work? The rational arithmetic. It looks to be very precise, no loss of precision. It should always give exact results. And I will always get the approximate floating point value of the final result without losing precision in the intermediate operation. But there will be some cases where things will not work. First of all, I would like you to come back to this. Do you appreciate the fundamental fact that 99.9854 is not same as 100? So let us first comment on this. Is this difference significant or insignificant? Yes, the first question. I am doing some arithmetic. I should have got result as 100. Instead, I got 99.9854. Is this difference significant or insignificant? Insignificant. Everybody agrees it is insignificant? No, some people don't agree. Why it is not insignificant? This is the problem with you. You are not willing to go outside the domain of very well-defined question and very well-defined answer. The question of whether a value is significant or insignificant entirely depends on the context. Now, whenever you are saying it is insignificant or whenever somebody is saying it is insignificant, one is creating a context in one's mind, and in that context, one is answering this question. Let me give you two possible contexts. One context is there is some additional remuneration that is to be given to an individual based on number of hours worked multiplied by hourly rate or something. And that is a fractional number, and it turns out that the person should be paid 99 rupees and 98.54 paise. Now, clearly anybody who is trying to pay, let's say, integer sum of rupees, because that is the tradition, this sum will be updated to 100. The difference is insignificant. Suppose somebody says, nahi toh main chillar hi dunga, so I will get 99 rupees and 98.54 paise, which is actually at least equal to 99 paise. I lose 1 paisa. If I am generous, I will say, chalta hai. Insignificant. If I am not, I will say I have sweated down, give me my 1 paisa extra. Because I will show the rational calculation. In general, you would agree that in case it is a question of rupees, then 100 rupees and 99.98 rupees, the difference is insignificant. Imagine now that this is the velocity setting calculation for a spacecraft which is being fired from Sriharikota and which is supposed to go to moon. And the setting is to be done by the calculation of certain parameters which take into account variety of things. It should have been 100, but it is 99.9854. Will that be insignificant? The spacecraft will never find the moon. In fact, you will be very lucky if it escapes the gravitational pull of the Earth itself. You never know. So please remember this in the general context of problem solving. Whether an error is insignificant or significant depends entirely on the context. Some of you would be doing civil engineering and designing bridges. Some of you would be doing aerospace engineering and designing structures for the aircrafts. When you design these structures, you have to define certain basic minimal characteristics of these structures. That they will bear so much load in case of bridges, or they will bear so much of stresses due to the winds and external factor in case of aircraft. All those parameters are to be calculated as exactly as possible. Suppose you certify an aircraft fit to carry so many tons of weight and so many people. And let us say you have an error of this kind of percentage, and that aircraft is loaded with someone as thin as a 40-pound child But because that child is added to the aircraft comes down the bar. Not acceptable. So please always remember this. Before answering significant or insignificant, you should always ask this question to yourself, what is the context? And construct in your mind not one scenario. That is the mistake that most of you do. You construct one scenario and come to a conclusion, this is insignificant or this is significant, or this matters or this does not matter. My suggestion is very simple. The moment you construct one scenario and come to a conclusion, try to construct an exact opposite scenario. So be imaginative. Imagine some other context. At least, even though that context is hypothetical or does not apply to the consideration that you have in your mind, you will know that yes, such possibilities exist. That is the way to approach problems. Anyway, I will be putting up the programs, these programs as well as the other things on the Moodle. Those of you who are interested in looking up more should read these and should once again read the definitions given in the Kuhn, which is the standard textbook. But the C++ tutorial on the web is fairly exhaustive. It gives all the definitions of how these functions are defined. There are a few things which I have not covered here. The additional aspects of object-oriented programming I will not be discussing in the class. And therefore, those of you who are interested in reading more should study these things. These are French functions and these are related to advantages of object-oriented programming in inheritance and information hiding, which is natural for all objects. Polymorphism and inheritance are two terms which we have not discussed in this course. Polymorphism and inheritance lead to a far greater power that becomes available to the class libraries. So those of you who are interested should read more about these two features of object-oriented programming and the explanations given. Kuhn's book itself explains some of these concepts, although it uses extensively the same EZ Windows library to explain these concepts. So while EZ Windows is not part of the final exam as I just declared at the beginning, and therefore a majority of you would have discarded that from your mind, those of you who wish to study polymorphism or inheritance from Kuhn's book should remember that the examples given actually expand on the EZ Windows. So we'll stop at this.